Hello and welcome to a new video about electrohydraulic. We're talking about control schemes, electrochromatic control schemes. Last time we talked about how basically a control scheme is working. Today I want to present you one control scheme with an impulse valve. One example, and we try to analyze this. It's not too complicated, all right? So what do we have? What have we got here? This is the pneumatic part. This is the electrical part. Pneumatic part, one cylinder, one limit switch at the outside world. We have an impulse valve. So this means an impulse here is sufficient to control this. If we have an impulse here, it will move to this direction. If we have an impulse here, we have moved to this direction. The impulse can end after the switch, does not really matter. So this has storing capabilities, this valve. So let's assume our cylinder is currently inside. So at zero position, we are inside. And then let's have a look there. PG1 is not operated, it's like that. S1 is not operated, it's like that. So this means K1 and K2 are powerless. If they are powerless, they are switched in this direction. So at the normally closed contact, the normally open contact is open because it's normal now. And so the coils MB1 and MB2, they are not energized. Nothing. Then somebody is pressing button S1. Okay, then we have here this normally open contact is closed. K1 is energized, the coil of K1 is energized, and it will switch from normally closed to normally open contact. If here this K1, it's in path number 3, if here this K1 is now switched, we have here a connection. The connection will energize MB1. MB1 is now energized. This will mean the switch is, the valve is switched to the other direction. If the valve is switched to the other direction, this is moving outwards. During moving, we can already release S1, because it's an impulse valve. Even if you release S1, this will no longer be energized. This will fall. If this is falling, then this will also be not energized. However, the valve will stay that way and we will finish the movement regardless on how long S1 is pressed. So one thing is for sure certain. Cylinder MM1 is traveling out. What is happening now? Now PG1 is pressed. Now PG1 is pressed, and if PG1 is pressed, it will close here. This K1 will be K2. Sorry, this is a this sign is a 2. This K2 will be energized. Duck, we are closing here to the normally open contact. Is closed, energized. MB2, MB2 is energized. This will switch back to this position. MM1 will start to travel inwards. If MM1 is traveling inward, it will release PG1, and PG1 is released. However, this will no longer be energized. This is causing this to fall, and this will also be no longer energized. However, since this is an impulse valve, we are storing the last information and we will travel inwards. Finito. This is what is happening. I can control it like this, BG1, If I'm not having an impulse valve, but some valve which is somehow spring, maybe a 5-3 way valve or something like this, then I need to keep this coil energized. Then I need to store the information somehow. This is not that easy. With impulse valves, it was relatively easy. Okay. Controls with impulse valves. Yeah. Good. Next time we actually do pretty much the same. Yeah. Here we have an issue. Here we have an issue. What is the issue? If I press the button, keep it pressed. Alright, I keep the button pressed. And now we are also activating this. Up to when I travel out, there's no difference. Then I have activated this and this. I just do not release the button. I have activated K1 and K2, so I have activated MB1 and MB2. Book, overlapping, signal overlapping. What to do about this? Next video we'll talk about that. How to solve this issue. For this time, thank you very much for listening. Goodbye.